Well, hello everyone. So today we are going to discuss the lecture number 3, and the topic for today's lecture is health and safety measures that we should take care when we are dealing with welding processes. In the previous two lectures, we just covered the introduction to welding processes. Next, we just covered the classification of welding processes. I hope these two lectures are quite clear to all of you. Now today, we are going to discuss what are the health and safety measures in welding. But before discussing the health and safety measures, I would like to tell you the definition of hazard. Actually, hazard is a term that we use to encounter in our day-to-day life. So we must be knowing what is the meaning of this term hazard. Hazard is something that has potential to cause us harm. Hazard is something that has potential to cause harm. Or it can lead to damage of health. So anything that has potential to cause us harm or it can lead to damage of our health, that is considered as hazard. Hazard itself can be in the three forms. It can be physical hazard, it can be chemical hazard, or it can be general safety hazards. We will be discussing the examples of each case. Like it is the first case, that is physical hazard. Under this category comes hazard from electric shocks or radiations or flames will come in the chemical hazard category, or fire explosion, or noise. So all these are the good example of physical hazard. Next, if we will say the another form of hazard, that is chemical hazard, under this category comes the hazard from gases, fumes, solvent, inert gases, etc. So any damage to our health or any harm that we are getting due to these parameters like gases, fumes, solvent, inert gases, they come under the category of chemical hazard. And if the damage to our health is due to any electric shock, due to radiations, flames, fire explosions, noise, then it comes under the category of physical hazard. The last form of hazard is general safety hazards. The damage that is caused to our health because of movement of heavy objects from one place to another. Then we term it as general safety hazard. when the hazard is due to the movement of any heavy object, it may be the machine, from one place to another, the harm that is caused to us comes under the category of general safety hazards. So, there are three forms of hazards that we have discussed till now. If we are encountering these hazards in our working environment, then we need to encounter this. We need to provide safe working environment. What we need? We need to provide safe working environment. But the question arises, how? How we can provide safe working environment when we are encountering with these types of hazards that we discussed? Actually, what we need? We need to minimize or reduce it to zero if it is possible, the effect of these hazards. What we need to do? We need to minimize. How we will minimize the effect of these hazards? So for this, we need to follow general safety guidelines that are being issued by or given by OSHA, which is better known as Occupational Safety and Health Administration. Occupational Safety and Health Administration. This association has given us 10 safety guidelines that we should take care while we are dealing with the welding processes or while we are dealing in an environment where welding is being done. So the number one guideline that is being issued by or given by OSHA is compressed gas cylinders should be kept away from heat sources. It should be at least 20 feet. At least 20 feet away from any combustible source. From any kind of heat source that is there, we should keep our gas cylinders, compressed gas cylinders, away from heat sources and at least 20 feet. Next, the piping systems must be well tested. must be well tested and proved gas tight. The piping system should be taken care of when we are welding, and they must be well tested and proved gas tight. Moreover, the operating pressure of these piping systems or pipes, it should be 1.5 times, 1.5 times the pressure of the pipe, or the limit of pressure of the pipe, should be 1.5 times the maximum operating pressure that we are dealing with. Maximum operating pressure, we should keep in mind this thing also. Whenever we are looking for piping systems, the pressure that the pipes can handle, it should be 1.5 times the maximum operating pressure. Next point is hoses showing leakages or any kind of opening other than leakages, burns, worn out places, used hoses showing worn out structure, leakages, burns, they should be immediately if possible repaired, and if repairing not possible, then they should be replaced. Also, the welders or cutters, the persons who are doing this type of operation, they should be well trained. Any unskilled welder, he will not be a welder if he is unskilled. If any unskilled person should not be given the task of welding, as it is another aspect of a hazard. I hope all the 4 points are clear till now. We will be discussing another points if these are clear. The first point is compressed gas cylinders. They should be kept away from the heat source, any combustible material, at least 20 feet away. The piping system, it should be must well tested and proved gas tight before we are going to operate. And the pressure limit of these pipe system, it should be 1.5 times the maximum operating pressure. Hoses, if they are worn out, if they are having burns, leakages, they should be immediately, if possible, repaired. If not, they should be replaced. And the welders or cutters, they should be trained. They should be well trained, in fact. Any unskilled person should not be given the task of welding. Next point, that is guideline number 5, the welders should wear non-combustible screens along with low reflectivity screen. Along with low reflectivity screen. What is the advantage of this if the welders are wearing non-combustible screens along with low reflectivity screen? It helps in absorbing UV radiations. That's why The welders are suggested to wear non-combustible screens along with low refractivity screens. Next point is suitable fire extinguishers must be maintained. Suitable fire extinguisher equipment must be maintained or placed in such a way that they are ready for instant use. Must be maintained or placed for instant use. It should not happen that you need fire extinguishers at a time and they are away. They are very far away and you are taking time to bring them. No welding. Point number 7, or I must say the guideline number 7. Operation should be performed. No welding should be performed on used drums remind this thing, barrels, until they have been thoroughly cleaned. We have to keep in mind that we should not perform any welding operations on used drums or barrels, otherwise it is another aspect of an hazard or an injury. We are provoking an injury if we are doing this type of an activity. They must be used and only after cleaning operation. Number 8, eye protection must be used and especially whenever we are doing arc welding. Especially for arc welding processes. Resistance welding, this type of an activity, that is arc welding, is being performed and you can find it anywhere, where even on a shop where you are watching any kind of a welding, they usually perform a arc welding process. So eye protection must be used, and you might have seen this also. Even if you are going to perform an experiment in your colleges, in your laboratories, then you will be given any spectacle for that. Goggles for that. They are specially designed for this purpose. Ninth safety guideline is special ventilation or respirators. Special ventilation or respirators are required when in confined spaces. Confined spaces for cleaning compounds, especially when fluorine compounds are encountered. We need to put an extra arrangement of ventilators, special ventilators or respirators when we are dealing with fluorine compounds. Encountered. Last but not least, the 10th safety measure, warning labels are required for all filler metals and fluxes. For all filler metals and fluxes. It is one of the necessity that we should be knowing the what is the warning label of any kind of filler metal that we are using or fluxes. I hope the guidelines that is given by OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration, are clear. These are 10 guidelines and they are very basic when you will perform welding in your laboratories or in any other workshop, in any industry. You will see that all these guidelines are written there, and the workers, the welders, they are specially trained. They use such type of, they follow such type of guidelines when they are working in the environment where welding is being done. Next topic of this lecture is risk assessment. When we are dealing with such type of environment where there are very much chances of causing hazards, of having hazards on a human, there is a need to assess the risk also. It is very important. And if you will see, welder itself is the person who can most effectively assess the risk or harm, because he is the actual person who is working in the environment. So he can be the most effective person if we want to assess the risk. What is risk assessment actually? It is the probability of an incident. It is the probability of an incident or exposure it is the probability of an incident or exposure it may be low, it may be moderate, it may be high risk. So the two questions are clear here. If we want to assess the risk, who is the person, most suitable person or effective person who can tell us the most effective way of assessing the risk is welder. And what is risk? It is the probability of an incident or exposure. It may be low, it may be moderate, or it may be high. Now, the first case is electricity or electric shock. Electricity or electric shock. If any person who is working in such environment, if he get struck by an electricity or electric shock, what damage it can cause to that person, it can result in death of that person, or sometimes severe burns. If a person encounters this type of an hazard, then it can result in severe death, or it can result in severe burns also. How you need to control, or how you need to reduce the risk due to electricity or electric shock? We can control it by taking care that we don't touch live electrical parts. We should not touch live electrical parts, as they are inviting you that you touch them and they will give you a shock, and it can result in burns, sometimes it can result in death also. You should take care that you should wear dry, hole free insulating gloves. Do not wear gloves that are wet. Don't touch electrode with bare hands. Always use gloves. Bare hands. Insulate yourself. Insulate yourself from workpiece and ground. I'm writing workpiece like this, and ground, using dry insulating mats. Using dry insulating mats or rubber boots. Always try to wear rubber boots, or you should be having a dry insulating mat where you are standing, so that you can insulate yourself from workpiece and ground. Lastly, do not bound or wrap cables carrying current around yourself. Cables carrying current around your body, any part of your body, around your body. Do not do such type of stupid activities that you are rounding the cable that is carrying the current. It will give you a shock also. So these are the five parameters that you need to take care when you are going to minimize the risk that is caused due to electric shock. Number one, do not touch the live electrical parts. Wear dry, hole-free insulating gloves. Don't touch electrode with your bare hands. Insulate yourself. You can either wear rubber boots, or you can insulate using drying insulating mats, and do not wrap cables carrying current. If you will take care of all these things, you will be able to work in a better environment, healthy environment. Next is gases and fumes. How you need to minimize the risk due to gases or fumes. This comes under the category of which type of hazard? It comes under the category of chemical hazards. What it can cause, if this type of hazard is there, what it can cause? It has a potential to harm us. It can cause respiratory problems. It can lead to eye irritations. It can cause irritation in your eyes. It can cause respiratory problems, thus directly affecting our lungs. So another hazard that is very injurious for us, very harmful for us, because it can lead to eye irritation, sometimes it can lead to respiratory problems, and that respiratory problems means they are directly affecting our lungs. How we need to control? Keep your head out of fumes. Where you will see the fumes, do not push your head towards the fumes. You have to keep your head away from the fumes. Don't breathe fumes. Try your best that you will not breathe the fumes. I will tell you that more than 90% of the fume arises due to vaporization of the electrode. When the electrode vaporizes, then chances of coming of fumes takes place, and around 90% fumes are generally arised because of the vaporization of electrode. Use mechanical ventilation or exhaust. Use mechanical ventilation or exhaust at the arc. Where the arc is being initiated, you need to use mechanical ventilation or exhaust, so that chances of gases or fumes that are coming, they will get a path, they will not directly affect your body. Follow OSHA guidelines. What is OSHA? Occupational Safety Health Administration guidelines for permissible or allowable exposure limits for various fumes. It is always better that you follow OSHA guidelines, so that you will be knowing what is the exposure, allowable exposure limit for different types of fumes. Next comes, that is third hazard, and how you need to minimize the risk in that hazard. That is under the category of physical hazards. And it is very common when we are dealing with certain kinds of welding operations, that is noise. It is actually third one. So we know that when we are performing welding operations or cutting operations, then noise of high frequency are being created. How you need to control those? But before controlling, we need to know what it can cause to us, what hazard it can cause to us. It can lead down ear problems. It can lead to ear problems. Sometimes you will feel exhausted within the time. If you are working in an environment, you will feel exhausted very early. If you are listening to a sound that is not allowable by you, that is above the allowable permissible limit, then it will result to ear problems, irritations. It can lead to decline your working efficiency also. How you can control the risk? You should have health and safety regulations guidelines given by OSHA at the machine process. or throughout the workshop, so that you should have health and safety regulation guidelines with you that are given by OSHA at the machine process or throughout the workshop shop, so that you can see how much permissible frequency of sound is there. If it is above, then you will be facing certain problems that we had discussed. You always need to measure it. You always need to measure noise level in decibels. We measure this in decibels. I'm denoting it by dB. And you have to identify and need to identify where noise levels are excessive. So you need to use such practices that you need to measure the noise levels. You will be measuring in decibels, and you need to identify at which part of operation, at which process the noise levels are excessive, and you need to try that. You need to reduce such type of noise levels. Smart people, what they use? They use earplugs or ear defenders when they are working in a environment where they are performing welding applications. So the next hazard is in the form of magnetic fields. Since we know that during welding operations, the current flows in the cables, and when the current flows, then there are strong chances of generation of these magnetic fields. What harm it can cause? It can cause heart problems. It can lead to stop your breath also. The heartbeats are also slowed down. So the people who are facing heart problems, they are suggested not to work in such environments where there is a strong generation of magnetic fields. How we can control magnetic fields? The company should put warning notices at all those points where there is a strong possibility of generation of magnetic field, where there is a possibility of generation of magnetic fields. You might see also that the warning symbols are made there, and they have tried to mention that strong magnetic fields are being generated here. So you need to avoid that. You need not to come in the path of magnetic fields. The last point of our lecture is manual handling. It is a category of general safety hazards. What harm it can cause? It can generally cause back injury, and not only in the working environment where welding process is being practiced, in general cases also, where you are moving heavy equipment from one place to another, you will be suffering from such type of injuries, that is termed as back injury. So we need to avoid. What we need to do? We need to avoid it. We will call some more workforce for our help, or we will use a mechanized system. Use mechanized system for movement of heavy objects. So, well class, that's all we have today in our lecture. It is quite a theoretical one, but it is a very important aspect of welding also. That's why we discussed it. And in this lecture, that is health and safety measures in welding, we discussed what do we understand by the term hazard. Then we covered the 10 guidelines that are being given by OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration. Sometimes these types of guidelines become theoretical. I hope I try to make it more interesting, but we need to understand, we need to follow the guidelines if we are working, because they are directly affecting our health. So this is a very important issue. Next, we discuss the risk assessment, and we discuss that welder itself is the person who can effectively assess the risk. Then how we can control the risk in case of noise, in case of gases, fumes, in case of electric shocks, in case of magnetic fields and manual handling. Thank you class for listening, for patiently listening to us this lecture. We have covered 3 lectures of welding. Next we will be covering the lecture number 4. Thank you.